Hello everybody. Today we're going to be seeing a very fast, quick start with Kuma. Kuma is a CNCF service mesh that supports pretty much every environment. It supports Kubernetes as well as virtual machines. You know, we can take a look at all the different distributions that are being supported from here, and we can also run these on AWS Fargate, EKS, and so on and so forth. Now, the nice thing about Kuma is that we can also mix and match Kubernetes and universal virtual machine environments into one single mesh. To get started with Kuma, we can go on kuma.io and then explore the installation options that are available. We can, for example, look at the macOS installation, which is what I'm going to be running today, and follow the instructions. I've already did this on my computer. So once we follow the instructions, we're going to be having access to Kuma Cattle, which is the built-in CLI that Kuma provides on every download. I also have an empty cluster of Kubernetes running on Minikube. So first things first, let's install Kuma. To install Kuma, we can run Kuma Cattle install control plane, and we can pipe this information inside of Kubernetes. By doing that, we are effectively installing the control plane. And out of the box, this will create a new namespace in Kubernetes called Kuma System. And within this Kuma System namespace, we're going to be having one service, and in this case, one pod, and that's the control plane. Again, Kuma supports Envoy as the data plane proxy technology, but with Kuma, there is no Envoy expertise that is required to use the service mesh. We abstract away all the most common use cases into native policies that you can use. And we're going to be taking a quick look at this in just a second. But if there is a policy that we don't support in a native way, then we can use the proxy template policy to go low level and change the underlying Envoy configuration. So if there is something that Envoy can do, but Kuma does not yet in a native policy, that means that by using the proxy template configuration, we can still have access to the entire Envoy ecosystem. So this should be up and running right now, and we can port forward the GUI that Kuma provides to take a quick look at what is the status of our service mesh right now. Of course, it's going to be empty on port 5681. It's going to be empty, but that's okay, because we can start a very simple demo application that shows you how to use the service mesh. So first and foremost, Kuma also exposes an HTTP API. So we can use the HTTP API to explore all the state of the resources, including all the meshes that we have running on the system. Kuma is a multi-mesh system that has been designed for the enterprise architect. So we can have one deployment of Kuma and as many compartmentalized meshes as we want. But if I go on slash GUI, we're going to be loading the GUI that comes out of the box with Kuma. And this GUI is built on top of the same HTTP API that I just showed you. As a matter of fact, you can also use the Kuma Cattle CLI to explore the status of the resources. And Kuma Cattle really also consumes that same HTTP API to retrieve this information. So we got Kubernetes resources, if you run it on Kubernetes. We got a built-in CLI, a built-in HTTP API, and a built-in GUI for the service mesh. This comes out of the box. Now, this is a standalone deployment of Kuma, which means that we are going to be running this in one cluster. There is many other ways we can deploy Kuma. For example, we can deploy Kuma in a multi-zone mode. And with multi-zone, we can support effectively multiple zones that are either Kubernetes or virtual machines within one cluster. So we can also have hybrid, multi-cloud, hybrid containers and virtual machines. It's very powerful when it comes to that. So let's take a look at our GUI. Let's go back to it real quick. So in the GUI right now, we can explore how many meshes we have. There is only one, and it's a default mesh. Everything is disabled. There are no data plane proxies whatsoever. Kuma by default support three different data plane proxies, a standard data plane proxy that we're going to be automatically injecting next to every service, an ingress data plane proxy. This is used in multi-zone, and because we're not using that mode right now, we're not going to be seeing ingresses here. And if we want to expose some services within the mesh to the outside world, and we want to do that via an API gateway, like Kong, for example, we also support the gateway data planes that are going to be running next to our API gateways. So it's quite comprehensive when it comes to the data plane proxy modes that we can support. And, you know, services can be internal, can be external. This is a complete service mesh ready for production. Well, obviously, right now, there is no application running. So I have built a very simple demo application that you can check out at my username, subnetmarco/kuma-demo. And this is a very simple demo application that will show a front end that will allow us to increase a counter on Redis. Very simple. So let's go to that demo application and let me install it. Now, whenever we create any service in Kuma, we can annotate the namespace to instruct Kuma to automatically inject the Cycler proxy. This is the annotation that we have. And if I check out my Kubernetes namespaces, we're now going to be having a new Kuma demo namespace. So if I look into this new Kuma demo namespace, we're going to be seeing the demo application, which is going to be serving the front end and Redis initializing right now. Now, as they are being initialized, effectively Minikube is now downloading the containers. We should be seeing our data plane proxy coming in the GUI, but they're still offline. They're offline because our services are not ready. Kuma will check the status of the underlying service, the status of Envoy. We have deep status checking in such a way that we show exactly where things go wrong, when and if they go wrong. If we do wait a little bit longer, now we do have our pods initialized, and we can see there is two containers per pods. One of them is the Envoy Cycler injection. And if I do refresh the GUI, we can now see these data plane proxies coming online. Now, one of the cool things about Kuma is that we can tag our workloads with custom tags that we can then use in our policies, like traffic routing, for example, to determine, you know, to effectively select in a more fine-grained way how we want our service mesh behavior to be reflected in production. So let's take a look at this application. Right now, if we take a look at our internal services, we see that there is a demo app service, one out of one data plane proxies, and then there is a Redis service. I can expose our demo application in such a way that we can start using it. And it's going to be on port 5000. And if I load port 5000 here, we're going to be seeing our demo app. This is a very simple demo application that allows us to increment our Redis counter. As a matter of fact, I can create some traffic and generate some traffic automatically in such a way that if we disrupt this traffic, we're going to be seeing the results immediately. Now, this traffic is working because by default, we do have traffic permissions that enable all traffic from every source to every destination. And also by default, this is a service mesh that has mutual TLS disabled. So this traffic is unencrypted. So let's go ahead and enable zero trust security in one click. We can do that by exploring the mutual TLS policy, which allows us to enable mutual TLS automatically in one click across all the services within the mesh. We can choose different certificate authorities. We can choose built-in. We can choose provided to provide our own certificate authorities. And the examples are very simple. On Kubernetes, we're going to be using kubectl to apply a new resource on our default mesh that will enable mutual TLS with a built-in backend, which will automatically create the CA for us. And then we're going to be instructing Kuma to automatically rotate the data plane proxy certificates every day. Now, this is quite interesting. We're going to be applying this one policy. And out of the box, we provision the CA, we rotate the certificates, no matter if we have one data plane or hundreds of thousands of data planes across multiple services. This is how easy it is to use zero trust security with Kuma. So on Kubernetes, we're going to be using kubectl, but of course, because Kuma also supports virtual machines, we can also run it on universal mode. Universal mode, it's a simple YAML declarative config that we're going to be applying with Kuma Cattle, our CLI. So we're trying really to make the experience quite similar between Kubernetes and virtual machines, in order to please all sorts of application teams out there, even the ones that are not familiar with Kubernetes yet. But because we're running on Kubernetes, we're going to be adding these policies. So I'm going to be pulling up my editor, adding some syntax highlighting, and I'm going to be echoing this policy into kubectl. And I'm going to be copying this and pasting it into my terminal in such a way that neutral TLS is going to be enabled. All we need to do is to apply this configuration. We can refresh our data here, and we can see that there is neutral TLS enabled on the default mesh. Now, like I said, the only reasons why these counters are still being increased, it is because we do have a traffic permission out of the box. But that doesn't have to be the case. Traffic permissions allow us to determine, you know, who can consume what within the mesh. But if we go ahead, and I'm going to show you, if we go ahead and we delete those traffic permissions from our mesh, automatically this traffic will stop working. In order for the traffic to be working again, we must re-enable that traffic again. So we can go to our policies, we can see traffic permissions here, we can click traffic permissions, and then we can look at the example policy that's being displayed in such a way that we can re-enable all traffic to flow again across the board. And so I can do that, and I can create my command here that we're going to be applying inside of kubectl. If I do that, we're going to be seeing our traffic automatically restored because this is all live, and there we go. Traffic is allowed again. That is quite simple to use, and it's a quite powerful way. Now, you know, all of these would be very useful to visualize on top of Grafana dashboards. And so in order to simplify that, you know, Kuma provides different policies for observability, metrics, traces, logging. We can enable some default metrics in Kuma on Prometheus and Grafana. To do that, we have some helpers. So we can install Prometheus and Grafana out of the box by using kubectl install metrics. And if we do that, this will create a new namespace in Kubernetes called Kuma metrics. And if you look at the pods within Kuma metrics, we can see that Grafana and Prometheus are currently being downloaded in my Minikube instance. Now, as we wait for that, we can take another look at the GUI, and we can see that these services are now popping up within my interface here in such a way that we can identify all the services that we're running and, of course, all the data plane proxies that are associated to them. So this is going to be taking just a little bit because we do have lots of pods and services and containers that I'm downloading right now, but it's not going to take much longer. So in the meanwhile, let's go ahead and look at the traffic metrics policy, which will allow us to enable automatic collection of our metrics within Kuma. As you can see, simplicity of the entire system is something that really we put lots of effort in because we wanted service mesh to be simple to use, simple to install, simple to scale. And this is a standalone deployment. If it were to be multi-zone, it would be as simple. So here is my mesh resource with the mutual TLS that I specified before. I'm going to be adding a new metrics entry in order to enable metrics. But before I do that, I want to make sure that finally our Prometheus and Grafana are running, almost running. I'm seeing that there is one that's missing here. And there we go. Everything is running now. So I'm going to be taking this policy, updating it in our kubectl configuration. And by going to the meshes again, we can see that now we have metrics enabled. So metrics are enabled. We're ready to go to visualize them. Kuma comes with the Grafana dashboards out of the box that we can use to visualize the traffic. So let's export Grafana and expose Grafana in such a way that we can start accessing it in the Kuma metrics namespace. And we're going to be using port 3000. So let's go here, port 3000. And this is a new brand new installation of Grafana, which means that we have admin
as username and password, and we're now logged in. There you go. Lots of pop-ups coming up, but here we go. By default, we have four different dashboards. So first and foremost, we can see the status of our mesh in the last 5 minutes. We can see the number of data planes. We can see the bytes flowing to Envoy. We can then, and this is, you know, for each individual mesh, we can then take a look at the service-to-service traffic that we have, let's say from our demo application front-end into our Redis service. This is the traffic that's being generated right now automatically, as well as we can take a look at each individual data plane. So Redis right now, it's receiving lots of requests. And if you go on Redis and we expose the data, we can see exactly how much, how many requests we're processing. And obviously there is, you know, many charts that we provide, but one of the most exciting charts are in Kuma CP itself. So Kuma CP allows us to visualize the actual status of the service mesh, the status of how long it's going to take for the control plane to create the XDS configuration for Envoy. So here we can measure the performance itself of our service mesh. And, you know, we can see all sorts of parameters. Now, because we are running in standalone mode, we are not seeing the multi-zone charts. These ones are going to be empty, but, you know, we can still see pretty intensive amount of information that gives us a good overview of what is the current status of our service mesh. As you can see, in 10 minutes, we have installed Kuma, installed the demo app, we have enabled Zero Trust Security, we have enabled, installed Grafana and Prometheus, and enabled observability. This is how simple it is to run the mesh. Now, this is all running in the default mesh. Let's assume that we are going to be having another team using our service mesh, and we want to provision them a compartmentalized mesh. We can do that. We can go to the policies, we can explore the mesh policies, and within the mesh policies, we can provision as many service meshes as we want on top of one deployment of the Kuma. This is a multi-tenant system. Now, my computer is very slow right now. We have lots running on Minikube. That's why it's taking a while. But if I do create this new resource in Kubernetes, let's say that we want to provision a new mesh for our database team. We could be doing that. And if I create this new service mesh will show up in the GUI. And so we can see that in our GUI, we now have two meshes running. We have the default mesh, which has, you know, 8 services, including Prometheus and Grafana, and a few proxies. And then the database team is going to be having no proxies whatsoever. This is how simple it is to use Kuma and to provision as many service meshes as we want for our teams. Well, so thank you so much. You can get in touch with Kuma on the Kuma community channels, and you can also explore the enterprise offerings that have been created within the community by clicking this enterprise button here. And these will provide you with a list of products that expand and innovate on top of Kuma to address with any enterprise requirement you may have. Now, with that said, thank you so much. Check out the community on GitHub, Slack, meetups, community calls, and I'll see you at the next video. Thank you.